And in terms of the mic, it looks like everything is ready. So my name is Sabhid Fawki, and I'm the director of the Ukrainian Research Institute. And it is my distinct pleasure and honor to introduce our today's speaker, Guido Hausmann. But before I do that, I will say a few words about today's occasion. And it's we are very grateful for you for coming today. We have one of three named lectures that we have per year here at the Institute. And one is Paris Soccer Lecture dealing with contemporary politics and international relations. Another is Bogdan Karabci with a lecture on events dealing with literature and culture. And Vasily and Maria Petryshyn Memorial Lecture is specifically designated to invite prominent historians. And the fund for that memorial lecture was established by Dr. Volodymyr Petryshyn. It was in 1991, the year of Ukrainian independence. And the first speaker in those series was Dr. Marta Bohoshevsky-Homyak, then working at the National Endowment for the Humanities, and later for a long period of time, she was the director of the Fulbright Program in Ukraine. Among previous speakers were John Armstrong, a major authority, of course, on the history of nationalism. That was in 1998. Professor Andreas Kappeler spoke here in 2014. Our previous speaker was Professor Andrew Wilson from the School of Slavonic and East European Studies, University College London. And our today's speaker is Guido Hausmann, Professor of Southeast and East European History and Head of the History Division at Leibniz-Institute for East and Southeast European Studies, University of Regensburg. Professor Hausmann is an old friend of the Institute. He held a number of very interesting and important positions in his life, which included the serving as a lecturer in East European and Russian history at Trinity College in Dublin, as acting chair of modern and East European history at the Albert Ludwig University in Freiburg, and research assistant at the same university, acting chair of East and Southeast European history at the Ludwig Maximilian University in Munich. But one of the most distinguished positions that you ever held was, it seems to me, fellow at the Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute. And that's where we first met. And I'm really very happy to call Guido Hausmann my personal friend and a friend of the Institute. So Guido Hausmann's today's talk will be on Brest-Litovsk, 1918. And some people believe that after the first round of elections in Ukraine, that topic suddenly became even more important than it was when we first discussed it. So without further ado, I turn the floor to Guido Hausmann.
Thank you very much, Sabine, for inviting me, for introducing me. I'm very honored to give the Petryshyn lecture here at Hori, and I'm very happy to be back, actually, Howard, after 15 years, or more than 15 years. Yeah. I have two general remarks. The one is, of course, I'm very grateful that you have showed up today, because I know that's a day of hot political discussion, debates on the election in Ukraine yesterday. And I won't speak about politics, but about history here. But there's a bit of politics in my talk as well. And my second remark is, that I present work in progress. It is not that I have completed the book and I will kind of present you my main findings. But I became more and more attracted to the year 1918 in the last some 2 years, and I'm digging deeper and deeper, and I just would like to share some of my kind of first findings with you. I have no PowerPoint presentation today because I thought it does not make too much sense for this topic. I mean, some slides could illustrate something, but they don't give additional kind of something, and so I decided not to prepare a PowerPoint presentation. So, distinguished audience, the city of Brest is 226 kilometers or 202 American miles away from the capital of Belarus, Minsk. One might say that it is nearby, at least by American standards, but the Brest-Litovsk Peace Treaty of the Central Powers with the Central Rada in 1918 and the Minsk Protocol and the agreements on peacemaking measures of 2015 are far away from each other, not only time-wise, but also in terms of politics and political culture. If I have in mind the obvious difference of the political context at the end of World War I and the European early 21st century, one also has to remember, of course, the similarities. Russia was waging war against Ukraine since December 1917, and nowadays Germany, Russia, and the Ukraine were sitting at one table for important political negotiations in 1918 and again in 2015. Of course, other powers were also involved. In 1918, these were Austria-Hungary, Bulgaria, and the Ottoman Empire, while in 2015 it was Poland, at least at the beginning, and France. Very different issues were at stake in both events. Nevertheless, the three states mentioned first played a key role in both events. And this is a constellation that did not take shape very often in the 20th and 21st century. I don't want to overstress the similarities of these parallel situations. At the beginning of my talk, I would only point to the places and events. These are worth to recall also for letting you know the way how I came upon the topic of Brest-Litovsk in 1918. The Ukrainian and Russian Revolution never fascinated me as a student, neither the course of the events in Kiev and Petrograd, nor the crucial actors involved in these. And my teachers drew me to other topics, telling me that the revolutions of 1917-20 were not that essential to understand either the history of Ukraine or the history of Russia. It is politics, the events of 2013-14, that drew my attention to Brest-Litovsk 1918. So the two peace treaties of Brest-Litovsk, chronologically the first one being closed with Ukraine and second the one with Soviet Russia, will be well known to this audience. Today I'm going to talk about something which recent historical scholarship has termed the afterwar. Related publications explore mostly the transition from wartime violence to civil war violence in Central, Eastern, and Southeastern Europe. And they argue in favor of alternative time frameworks, for instance, 1912 to 1923, instead of 1914 to 1918, and a corresponding terminology, European Civil War instead of World War I, or other options. I would like to open up the term also for the follow-up debates and statements on the two peace treaties after 1918. It is no surprise that diplomats from 1918 were involved in these debates and that they were characterized by elements of legitimizing and rationalizing their own deeds or political positions in 1918. One might ask further how the eyewitness eyewitness accounts of the diplomats had an impact on further historiographies, and how we can understand current national historiographies as part of the legacies of Brest-Litovsk, which actively shape our historical understandings of post-1918 state building within the Soviet Union even today. And this is the topical point of my lecture today. The two peace treaties of Brest-Litovsk had an immediate political effect on Ukraine and also on Soviet Russia. The Ukrainian treaty gave birth to the Ukrainian People's Republic and opened the way for German-Austrian military support against the Bolsheviks. It also opened the way for the ensuing political and military suppression of Ukraine by the Central Powers. The other treaty with Soviet Russia saved the Soviet government with Lenin at its top. It is thus closely linked to the Soviet myth of origin. Both treaties had damaging economic consequences, for Ukraine certainly heavier ones than for Soviet Russia. Yet by the end of the year 1918, with the fall of the monarchies in Germany and Austria-Hungary, they lost their importance. The one with Soviet Russia declared null and void. It did not have a longer-term direct political impact. Now, taking this fact into consideration, it is too surprising to notice the effort the involved diplomatic staff and eyewitnesses spent on offering legitimations and broad historical interpretations of the peace negotiations. These moves can be observed on all sides. Regarding the Ukrainian side, surprisingly little attention has been paid to the delegates of the Central Rada. Very little is known about Vsevolod Holubovich, Oleksandr Srebnyuk, Mikola Lubinsky, Mikola Levitsky, to name just the best known, or some of the best known functionaries, diplomats. The reasons for the historiographical neglect might be related to their personal fate. So some of them emigrated after 1918, but returned during the first half of the 1920s to Soviet Ukraine and became then victims of Stalin's terror. Another reason might be that they were non-Bolshevik leftists. Third, they have not left much traces behind in terms of autobiographical notes or publications of political relevance. At least we have at our disposal the notes and materials of Pavlo Festyuk, published in Vienna 1921-1922. And Festyuk himself, he was not a delegate at Brest-Litovsk. Our colleague Mark von Hagen is doing research on him. We also have the accounts of the delegates Sevriuk, Zhelesniak, and Mikola Lubinsky, published between 1926 and 1928. And I would like to make here three general points on these publications from the interwar period. Two of them published in 1928 in Lviv, which are essentially a mixture between autobiographical notes and historiography. First, they legitimize their case, that is, the political order of the Ukrainian People's Republic, the diplomatic effort for a separate peace, and in general, the Ukrainian Revolution as a process distinctive from that of Russia. That also give, they also give insight into the actual making of the peace settlement, the recognition of the Rada delegation and of Ukraine as a state. The emergence and recognition of the state is the main goal of the narratives, as the loss of the state was one of the main topics of Ukrainian political thinking in interwar Poland. And if you take the account of Oleksandr Selyuk as an example, one can find here at least, well, one can find here various levels in the narrative he presents. The first level is his journey from Kiev to the demarcation line, then to Ternopil and to Lviv, which he recalls as a ruined Ukrainian Piemont. In Lviv, they met in a Frisi hotel New Year, and next day they continued the journey to Brest. The second level is in the increased alienation from the Soviet-Russian delegation. As a background for the formulation of their own political agenda. At the beginning of the account, Selyuk reports a discussion among the Ukrainian delegates in favor or against a joint stance with the Soviet-Russian delegation against the Central Powers. The discussion was then quickly abandoned, replaced by disappointment, alienation, and by a growing awareness of their separate interests and opinions. The Ukrainian delegates, for instance, did not believe in a socialist revolution across Europe, as the Soviet-Russian delegation believed in. The leader of the Soviet-Russian delegation, Adolf Joffe, for instance. And they noticed the disinterest of the Soviet-Russian delegation in Homshina, Pilyasha, and Galicia, whose political fate was close to the heart of the Ukrainian delegates. The second point related to these publications from the interwar period, they recall their questioning of the legitimacy of Bolshevik power in Soviet Russia during the peace negotiation. By the way, and this attitude is very strongly present in the minutes of the negotiations, which have been preserved in the state archives in Vienna. And I found it quite admirable to read this in the minutes and then again in the autobiographical notes. They were straightforward and far from political naive, as the notes of Christiuk and Strefjuk testify. Their struggle with Soviet Russia was clearly politically based. They were not anti-Russian at all. A further example of this line of argument is the book by Dmitry Doroshenko on the history of Ukraine from 1917 to 1923, published in Ushorod 1930 to 1932. Doroshenko, himself a member of the Central Rada in 1917-18, but not a delegate at Brest-Litovsk, quoted non-Bolshevik newspapers from December 1917, January 1918 from Soviet Russia, and they still existed at the time, which emphasized the fact that, and I quote him, the struggle of the Central Rada with the Bolsheviks could not be considered a struggle against Russia and the people of Russia, but a struggle with the enemies of the Ukrainian and as well as the Russian people. A third point is related to an article by Dmitry Donsov on the occasion of the 10th anniversary of the treaty. Donsov himself is also not present at the peace negotiations, and his article places its focus elsewhere. Ethnic Ukraine played an important role for him. Soborna Ukraina, the agreement on Holshina and Pilyasha as part of Ukraine, and of Bukovina and Eastern Galicia as a separate crown land in Austria-Hungary, an agreement which had damaged the relations of Austria-Hungary and Germany with the Poles and was lifted by Austria-Hungary by July 1918. The author phrases Brest-Litovsk 1918 as Mazepinsky Mir, which means that he opens up a broader historical picture of Ukraine's struggle for statehood. He essentially understood the Brest settlement as an anti-imperial and anti-Russian peace. In his own words, and I quote him, "The question of peace and war in Ukraine was decided in Kiev, not in Moscow," end of the quote. And roughly at the same time in 1926, the Ukrainian Marxist historian Matvey Yavorsky gave a class-based interpretation of the treaty, stating that, I quote him, "The Rada had sold the Ukraine to the bourgeoisie to retain its bourgeois independence," end of the quote. In Soviet Russia, Lenin has coined the term for the peace treaty with Imperial Germany already in March 1918 as a tilted peace, thus qualifying, I quote him, "the abyss of defeat, partition, enslavement, humiliation into which we have been thrown," end of the quote, turning Soviet Russia into a German colony. As the Pilsit Peace was, I quote him again, "the great humiliation on behalf of Germany and at the same time a turning point to the greatest national awakening," end of quote, Lenin was in 1918 calling for this awakening of Russia. And the Russian Marxist historian Mikhail Bukowski adopted and spread this interpretation in Soviet Russia during the 1920s. Ukraine's peace treaty and political independence were rarely mentioned, and if at all, then they were considered a result of nationalist or bourgeois mentality and of external influence. In this line of argument, the creation of the Ukraine was an instrument of subversion at the hands of Imperial Germany. And Lenin and Popovsky mostly talked about Germany and not about the Central Powers. And the Rada delegation was positioned against Soviet Russia. This was certainly the case, one might argue, but the delegation had nevertheless their own autonomous agency, a fact which remains totally erased and negated in the Soviet Russian accounts. The presumably instrumental character of the Ukrainian delegation was key to the writings of Trotsky as well, who temporarily led Soviet Russia's delegation in Brest-Litovsk. Trotsky, who was a victim of inner Bolshevik rivalry in the mid-1920s and forced to leave the Soviet Union, added, however, a new dimension to the hitherto mentioned interpretations of the peace negotiations in his autobiographical notes, and they were published in 1913. There he denigrated the Ukrainian delegates at Brest-Litovsk as provincial, quote him, and democratic naives. His dislike of the Ukrainians clearly shines through even 12 years after the negotiations. One might think that this was the result of his controversial, unsuccessful negotiation strategy at Brest-Litovsk, so neither war nor peace, and his further political and personal fate. But his attitude had not changed considerably compared to his History of the Russian Revolution to Brest-Litovsk, published in 1919, a text he wrote between the sittings of the peace conference. I would summarize his vision of the Ukrainian diplomats in 3 points: political naivety in a political power game, I quote him again, to the Ukrainian lower middle class, who were then in power, their recognition by the capitalist governments of Europe seemed the most important thing in the world, end of the quote. Class-based qualities of the delegates as ambition, pride, and political dependency. And third, he saw the Ukrainian delegation as traitors because they concluded a peace treaty behind our backs on the birthday of Prince Leopold of Bavaria, the General Commander in Chief of Oberost, 1916-1918. This is a Bavarian dimension in my talk, and I'm coming from Bavaria, so I, for the first time, came across this. It is obvious that the given interpretation of Ukrainians and Russians in the interwar period were more outspoken outside the Soviet Union than within. If we compare them on a general level, then I would say that the Ukrainian interpretations outside the Soviet Union are more focused on their own political agenda and distancing themselves from the Russian side, whereas the Russian positions, one could add here other voices to Trotsky's account, couldn't come to terms with the Ukrainian stance. A second point is that Lenin immediately placed the peace settlement in a larger historic context of the history of statehood, probably reflecting thus the continuous tradition of statehood in Russia, whereas Gonsov followed with a similar historical, though very different, interpretation for Ukraine only in 1928. After 1918, after the collapse of Imperial Germany and Austria-Hungary, some key negotiation leaders of the Central Powers in Brest-Litovsk, for instance, General Max Hoffmann, in 1918, the Chief of Staff to the Commander-in-Chief of Oberost, or the Austrian-Hungarian Foreign Minister, Ottokar von Czernin, published their autobiographical notes. And the these publications carry also a legitimizing character. And these writings, published also in Ukrainian, in the volume of Kedrin Rudnitsky in 1928 in Lviv, on the occasion of the 10th anniversary of the treaty, a positive view of the Ukrainian delegates and their political skills prevailed. But on the whole, Ukraine vanished from historiographical awareness in Germany, notwithstanding the publications of Ukrainian emigres in Germany, as, for instance, Dmytro Doroshenko. And the German and Austrian authors, not only those I mentioned, also held the intellectual and rhetorical skills of Trotsky in high esteem, which sets a certain ambivalence on their appreciation of Ukrainian independence. Diplomacy and historiography were closely intertwined in the case of Brest-Litovsk, at least in the interwar period, when autobiographical notes of former diplomats remembered the gain of Ukrainian statehood and formed historiographical standards. After 1945, autobiographical writing, similar to the kind of the interwar period, played a negligible role. Yet historiography and politics remained closely related, and particularly in the Soviet Union with its highly ideologized historical scholarship. The path of Western Germany was different here, and the so-called Fischer controversy in the 1960s contributed to a historical debate in Germany on whether a larger part of Imperial Germany, German society, had agreed with the annexationist policy in Eastern Europe during World War I or in 1918, and if a continuity from World War I World War I existed in this regard. Some research from that time, books from Borowski, Baumgart, and the Austrian historian Biel, are considered of value until today. But since the early 1970s, the topic somehow vanished from the screen again, and it has not really resurfaced until today. Interestingly, they tend to reaffirm the Soviet interpretation of not acknowledging Ukraine as a political actor of its own. I will be brief on the Soviet historiography during the decades between 1945 and 1991. Soviet Ukrainian historiography on the topic is limited and depended to a large degree on Soviet Russian historiography. The publications of the Kievan historian Rem Simonenko can be taken as an example. He published since the 1950s various books and encyclopedia entries on the topic, and was primarily interested in the attempts of the Entente and the US capital to gain influence in Ukraine at the end of World War I. The topic reflects a larger shift in Soviet historiography after World War II towards the history of the world, of the two world powers, the Soviet Union and the USA. Simonenko offered a class-based interpretation, emphasized the role of the Kharkiv Soviet Ukrainian Republic and the role of Lenin vis-a-vis Trotsky, as well as the Central Rada. But interestingly, he was one of the very few voices after 1991 who continued to point out the twisted legacy of Brest-Litovsk, the economic exploitation of the country by Austria-Hungary and Imperial Germany, and the simple need of military support in February 1918, which only the Central Powers could offer at that historical moment. And the Ukrainian diaspora during that time preserved the tradition of understanding Brest-Litovsk as a final and as a starting point of a separate Ukrainian historical process. And we have, of course, the publications by Petryshyn, Horak, and others. At the time, after 1945, Moscow historians directed Soviet historical scholarship, and in 1947, the influential study History of Diplomacy appeared in Moscow, which was translated into various languages. Among them also we have a German translation. That was a time to underline and highlight the traditions of Soviet diplomacy right after World War II, as did Isaac Minsk, one of the most influential historians in Stalin's Soviet Union, awarded with the Stalin Prize in 1943, but in 1949, already a temporary victim of Stalin's anti-cosmopolitan campaign. He viewed the Brest-Litovsk Treaty with Soviet Russia as a sounding victory of Soviet diplomacy, and of Lenin in particular, who is portrayed as a true peace fighter. Trotsky is denounced for his recognition of Ukraine, temporary recognition of Ukraine during the peace talks. The Ukrainian Rada is depicted as scheming, corrupt, and controlled by the foreign Entente powers, and is supporting the counter-revolution in Russia. And with this view, Minsk repeats, of course, the political Soviet position on Ukraine immediately after World War II. This had very little to do with historical scholarship. And essentially, this line of interpretation had not changed fundamentally until the end of the Soviet Union. There are other publications by Semyon Mayorov, above all by Chubaryan. And Chubaryan is, until very recently, was the director for global history, general history,
World
the Institute.
World history.
World history. Thank you very much. At Russia's Institute of History at the Academy of Sciences. And he's also sitting in all committees on German-Russian historical relations and German-Austrian historical relations up to now. So I would say that this has not changed very much since the 1940s and 50s. Essentially, his book from 1964 followed the same line as the Minsk interpretation. And finally, the end of the Soviet Union then created new and wider spaces for historical scholarship. Neither Ukrainian nor Russian colleagues were forced any longer to be conformed with the Soviet myth of origin in their publications on Brest-Litovsk. Politics and ideology could be disentangled from historical scholarship. The late Orest Subtelny published in the 1990s various articles about the scale of the damaging effect of the Soviet system on Ukrainian historical scholarship and pointed to the differences in comparison to Russian historical scholarship in that regard. I would argue that both sides, Ukrainians and Russians, have taken advantage of the new chance. Russia seems to be in an easier position with respect to Brest-Litovsk. The leading politicians and historians distance themselves from the Soviet state and from Lenin in particular. For Ukraine, the situation is different, was different, is different, because the myth of state building is closely linked to Brest-Litovsk, which still may limit the freedom of interpretation. The function of legitimizing politics is welcomed in both countries, but differently wise with respect to Brest-Litovsk. I see various strands in Ukrainian historiography developing about Brest-Litovsk in the past 15 years. One is classical diplomatic or political history of the kind of the historian of Ternopil, Ihor Datskov, employed in his books from 2008 and 2013. And one might add here the Kievan historian Pavlo Petulyak. These publications regard the context of peace negotiations and the Fourth Universal from the backdrop of a considerably broadened source base. But the conceptual focus is quite narrow. The narrative ends with the successful achievement of statehood and its international recognition. The acting persons are limited to the circle of political elites. More open in reflecting the various political options and political contexts is certainly the Kievan historian Valery Soldatenko, who has published a number of articles and co-authored a book on Ukraine in World War I. But I did not come across about a single book or a larger article to explore the devastating effects of military conquest and the economic exploitation of Ukraine in the months following the peace settlement, as if nobody wants to criticize Austria-Hungary or Germany. If I would single out one particular feature of Ukraine's historiography on Brest-Litovsk 1918 after 1991, I would stress it somehow isolationist, self-defense manner. It is easy to point here to transnational or entangled history, which has not been applied to the topic of Brest-Litovsk, to a need to open up the history of World War I in Ukraine, bringing together the front and the home front, politics and civil life, regional, national, and European dimensions. And I'm surprised to notice the lack of biographies on the Ukrainian delegates of Brest-Litovsk. I'm quite sure, or quite certain, that in other countries there would be such biographies. Empirical work is held in high regard by Russia's historians as well after 1991, and I take this as a sign of a process of professionalization. The topic of Brest-Litovsk has stopped to be part of a master or grand narrative. The book by the Moscow historian Irina Mikhutina on the Ukrainian Breast Peace, is the title of the book, published in 2007, explores in detail the escalation of the Ukrainian-Soviet-Russian relations in late 1917 and the first month of 1918, and shows how the economic situation in Austria-Hungary was a decisive factor in the conclusion of the treaty. She does not fully escape the interpretation of Ukraine as a political traitor of Russia, but at least she informs the reader of the political interests of Ukrainian actors, which is a step forward. More recent Russian publications by Alexander Shubin and others highlight the function of the Brest Peace Treaty for the survival of the Soviet Russian state, but as if it was a foreign country. It is also necessary to point to the limits in German historical scholarship, even more so because the chances had been better for extensive research in Germany than, for instance, in Ukraine. In general, I see two processes or phenomena. One is forgetting about and neglect of Brest-Litovsk Peace Treaty of 1918. Many colleagues in Germany still bypass the Ukrainian Peace Treaty at all, and they focus on the German-Soviet-Russian Peace Treaty. Colleagues with interest in the history of Ukraine are mostly researching World War II and have ignored Ukraine in World War I, as well as Germany's involvement in this war and in the year 1918, so in Eastern Europe. The other more positive process is the recent general interest in the history of World War I, which has gone far beyond the usual rising interest in jubilees and has triggered a new interest in the Eastern Front and in German politics in the East in particular. An important exception in this regard is the historian Frank Bolshevsky, whoever emphasizes very much in his research the exclusive instrumental character of Imperial Germany's policy with regard to Ukraine. To conclude, I would like to make a few more general points for our discussion. I started my talk with a reference to current politics, to the agreements in Minsk 2015, to Brest-Litovsk as a twisted historical reference point in this regard, and to the historiographies of Brest-Litovsk 1918 in the 20th century as part of the afterwar of World War I. Politics and historiography were closely related, and Brest-Litovsk is a formidable topic for historians to study, the relation between historical scholarship and politics. Historical scholarship reflects politics and political power relations, but it does reflect them in different ways. In the interwar period, the autobiographical notes of the participants of the Central Rada delegation opposed the official views of Soviet Ukrainian and Russian historiography and established its own historiographical strand, also among Ukrainian emigrants and in Polish society. This tradition and historiographical divides continued until 1991. Brest-Litovsk has a long history of political and ideological appropriation because it is part of a political myth of origin. And Ukraine after 1991 has adopted the legacy of the Ukrainian People's Republic politically. The situation in Ukraine since 2014 has been tempting for Ukrainian colleagues to point out the legacy of Brest-Litovsk politically, because Russia has threatened again the territorial integrity of the state and thus the state itself. The Ukrainian ambassador to Germany, Leonid Melnik, has made in 2018 a statement saying that the peace treaty of 1918 alerts to a peaceful solution of current Russia's war in Donbas and its conquest of Crimea. As a historian, I would point here to other traditions and perspectives. The historiography reflects the uneven political power balance between Ukraine and Russia. There's abounding evidence of a history of disrespect and disregard of Ukraine on behalf of Russia, as well of Germany. But there's also, from the Ukraine side, a history and historiography of self-respect, of national self-respect, and of self-defense. And these traditions and findings have to be integrated into a history of asymmetric power relations. What does this all mean for the space historical scholarship has in and about Ukraine, in particularly after 2014? Can we discuss it in a similar aloof and neutral manner as we do with about other countries, the topic of statehood, which has re-entered historical scholarship recently and which is regarded as the principal form of the organization of political power in modern European history? Quinn has chosen this particular form of political power organization in 1918 as a result of an interest of its national elites, not only its national elites, to renegotiate power relations with the previous supreme power center, Petersburg, Petrograd, as a result of war and violence, on the basis of political legitimacy, and it pursued certain strategies to sustain its political power, including rhetorical strategies, accepting foreign military help, and economic exploitation. We can and should explore this context in a comparative perspective, if there are similar cases. And Ukraine is a very complicated case in this respect. At least we should start, for instance, with the comparison of emerging states in 1917-18 in post-imperial Russia, and a comparison of German occupational regimes and local or national reactions towards it during World War I, in Poland, 1915-1918, Ober-Ost, 1917-18, and Ukraine, 1918. This would also open perspectives for linking national and transnational historical scholarship, and this is a strong trend in recent German historical scholarship. These topics seem to be, for me, one of the most urgent and difficult challenges for historians of Ukraine when we want to put Ukraine on the map of European history where it essentially belongs. Thank you very much.